to Nasty Knuckles, the Hockey Outlaws podcast, with your hosts, Derek Nasty Settlemyre and former Philadelphia Flyer enforcer, Riley Cote, as they go behind the scenes with your favorite NHL players. This week's guest is former NHL power forward, Scott Hartnell. Time to face off.
Hi, this is Nasty Knuckles Podcast, and I'm Riley Cote.
I'm Derek Settlemyre. Welcome to the first episode, and we're so happy to have our first guest ever, Mr. Scott Hartnell, the Bird Dog.
Thank you, guys. Thanks for having me. Scraping the bottom of the barrel already, you little Bird Dog.
Oh, man, we're so happy to have you, man.
Appreciate it.
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah, this is great.
I love the name, too, Nasty Knuckles.
Yeah, this is this guy. Yeah.
Knuckles?
Yep. Yeah.
Love it.
Yep. I appreciate you coming on, man. It's been a while since we sat down and shot the shit, so I appreciate your time.
It's been way too long, yeah.
Hopefully you can get some funnies going here today with some of the crazy stuff you've done in your hockey career and your time in Philly. So
we never really had any laughs over the years, have we, guys?
No, yeah, right?
Quite a few, man.
Yeah.
I have a question for you guys. I know who I think in my mind. I can answer this question, but who's a player that you guys played with that had the weirdest ritual, superstition, or just weird dude?
I would say right off the top of my head, great question, number one. Cliff Ronning, he was so superstitious about black tape, and obviously a white knob, white tape. He'd tape like all the way from like the hosel all the way.
Yeah, the sock. Right to,
yeah,
the sock.
Yeah. And if there was black tape anywhere around him, it was like he had to go pick it up, or if there was a black tape stick on the other side of the dressing room pointing anywhere towards his stall, he would have to go move the stick and put it on a different angle of a wall so it would go away from it. And I kind of pick up on guys like little rituals, how they, you know, tap their skate a couple times,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
and then
yeah,
they do all that kind of stuff. And, you know, if it works, they'll do the exact same thing. Obviously, yeah. I don't know if it's ritual or superstition, but, you know, Cliff Ronning was always, I was very interested in watching him all the time, just kind of move stuff. So no black tape was going anywhere near him.
That's wild. I've never heard that one before. That's good. What about you, Riggs?
My favorite centerman, Jimmy Dowd.
Oh, the junkyard.
Junkyard,
dog.
Jimmy Dowd.
What a beauty.
Just how precise he was with folding his socks, in slowly, fold his socks and place them in a stall and his tape.
Right.
And he had like three or four things of tape and his supplements and everything was just like so perfectly orchestrated. I mean, you could tell he'd been in the NHL for 20 years at that point just by how many different things he was doing. But it was interesting to watch. I mean, it was. I don't even know how he kept up with that many different little things. I mean, you could probably speak to it better than I can because you were there.
Yeah, he actually is funny. I kind of forgot about the junkyard dog as far as that goes. But when I would lift this stall up, he wore those awful gray shorts.
Yeah,
Softie or whatever, but they were too short.
Yeah.
I'm like, junkyard, like, come on, let's get some. No, can you get me any more of these, Nasty? Can you get some more of these? I'm like, you got 8 pair in there. Well, I'm going to need these when I'm done. You know, like, I want to get as many as I can. But everything was folded up, like you said. That's
so
true.
Perfect.
He came in and, like, if I would have just thrown stuff in his stall, I know I would have come back and it would have been perfect. Yeah. I witnessed a lot of you guys and all your little quirks. I think for me, watching Jordan Wheel, I love Wheelie.
Oh,
you guys didn't get a chance to play with him.
No, well, yeah. I coach Wheel.
Oh, so,
yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So, I know
so
a little bit about his
Wheelie, don't get mad at me, Wheelie. But it was, he sat in a chair. I had to go get him a chair from somewhere in the arena if there wasn't one in the hallway. And he would sit in it. And I think what he was doing was going up 12 flights in an elevator, door with his eyes closed.
Really?
Door opens first or second floor, third floor, and then come back down. But if he got interrupted, he'd start over. And then,
like,
he's
visualizing, or
he sat like this in the hallway. There'd be 100 people around. He'd just be sitting there. And then he started making moves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And he went through this thing, and some people come out like, "What the fuck's wrong with that guy?"
Yeah.
Like, nothing. He's just getting ready, you know.
Yeah.
And even my son would walk down the back hallway and Wheelie would be doing that. And I called Elvis and here holding a stick one, making all these movements. And it used to make me laugh. And then I had to tickle Briz from behind,
come
up and because I did that one night and he got a shutout. He was on my computer. He used to like to go on my computer before he started getting dressed. And I just came up behind him and went, "Look at you, you sound like the Pillsbury Doughboy." And I'm like, "What was that?" And he goes, "You tickled me, you know," and kind of laughed. So the next game, he's at my computer, and I came in and I hopped up on my desk area, and he goes, "Nasty, nasty up." You know, yeah. He's like, I'm like, what? He's like, tickle me. I was like, what? Tickling you? He goes, you did last game, a shutout. I'm like, oh my God. Come on behind him, hit him on the ribs.
The old fake laugh.
So it was great. Oh man.
How about the most intense warm ups you've ever seen? I'm gonna go with a guy named Trevor Gillies.
Oh, Trev.
Trevor Gillies, yeah. Fought him a couple of times. Awesome guy and absolute gamer, but the most intense warm-up you ever seen.
Yes.
I don't think he touched pucks either in warm-ups. It was heavy groin stretch, heavy hairy eyeballs down the other end, heavy cruising the red line.
He just looked mean, though. Oh. Like, he was a scary-looking man, but you talk about a gamer.
He's a gamer, man. He was hungry. He was looking for blood, for sure.
I remember Briz, too. Talking Briz stories now, but he's sitting there, you know, doing his pads up and... You know, and I sat, I think, two down from him, you know, in the skate zone there. And he come up, and he's speaking to me in Russian and, like, looks at me in the eyes, says, like, 3-4 sentences, like, you know, 30 seconds long or whatever, and then goes back and, you know, does another
wait
skate.
For you to reply in Russian or what?
And he says a couple, like, another words or whatever, like, looking at me, and I said, listen, I don't know what you said. You could have called me every worst word under the sun. I said, you talk to me in Russian one more time. I'm going high at you every practice from now on to the end of the year. And he's like, oh, sorry, Scotty. Sorry. I thought I was kind of in my own head. Sorry. I'm like, okay. I'm like, get me out of here. Get me away from this guy.
I remember the skates almost figured. I used to be, when I was there, I was all the way down the hallway from the old locker room. And I'd be in there doing something on the phone with a rapper or something. And I would hear him call, Nastya. Nastya, and I just stopped answering him because I'm like, I'm not going down there. So he would yell, and then one of the guys would be like, answer him, shut up, you know, like I hear the guys yelling. So I'd walk all the way down the hall, and he'd be standing there fully dressed. Do I look big today? I'm like, you look huge, Briz. No one's scoring on you. Okay, thank you. And he walked away. Call me down there just to say that. And that's why I wouldn't go down there. I'm like, I'm not going down. But guys would be like, just get down here, you know.
What a beauty.
Oh, man, he made me laugh that guy. Man. He was great.
Why don't you talk a little bit about your time in Philly and, you know, how you embraced the city and, you know, how you, you know, just carved out your own individual identity here and, you know, became a fan favorite.
Yeah, no, you look at the Philadelphia Flyers franchise and the players that played before us, the Broad Street Bullies, obviously everyone knows that name and kind of my style of play. So when I got traded here, I was like, wow, this could be a great fit for me, obviously. And, you know, Homer signed me to a nice 6-year ticket. And,
not bad.
I'll never forget my first exhibition game. First game wearing the Flyers uniform after the first period, you know, middle of September, you're trying to get your legs going, your wind going, timing going, all that kind of stuff. And, you know, going down the tunnel and some fan chirps down like, come on, Hartnell, hit somebody. And I'm like, I'm walking back and I look back and Mike Knuble's behind me. He goes, get used to it, Hart. There's going to be a lot of that. And I'm like, holy shit, like what'd I get myself into here? You know, so like next period I was out there just running everybody. And you know, the next period walk Mike goes, that'd be Hartsy. So that was my first introduction to be at a Philadelphia Flyer and just how much passion and everything this city has.
Awesome. Well, you were a fan favorite right off the bat, obviously. There are lots of things that happened while you were here. I mean, too many to really talk about today, but one of my favorite moments was you and Dion Phaneuf, because you guys had a little bit of a rivalry. We know about the All-Star game, the Sedin triplets, you know, you set the goal up, suck it Phaneuf, which was hilarious. I don't think he thought it was, but one of my favorite moments, I have a lot with you, obviously you were my favorite guys, but you're going to the net. Phaneuf hits you, knocks you down, and you kind of look back, but you come back around the net. You end up scoring. As soon as you score, you give him a whack and just drop him. I thought the roof was coming off the place. Talk about being a fan favorite in Philadelphia. Scoring a goal, dropping the mitts 2 seconds later, it was unbelievable. It was one of my favorite moments.
That was wild. He got cross-checked behind that, and he's a tough boy, right? Yeah. And he's a gamer, too. And, you know, I would say we're probably the same class, right, of fighters. And yeah, whacked that one in, and I wanted to go after him right after I got hit him. I'm like, oh, Ozone, maybe we'll score a goal. And, you know, it never really happens like that in a perfect moment. But like you said, just dropped it. And right after, actually, the All-Star game when the second FNUF came out. And...
Oh, you may get to stay on that line.
There we go. Yes, huh? It's the Dean Triplets. Yeah. He's going all. Second FNUF. Woo!
You know, everyone was having so much fun with that. And we're lining up at the face-off. And he actually burned me pretty good with this one. I was like, you know, hey, Dion. And I'm like, don't be mad, man, that I, you know, made fun of you and everyone's saying suck at FNUF. He goes, how was your first All-Star game, kid? I was like, you enjoy it? You get some autographs? And I was like, put my head down. And I'm like, oh, man. Felt so stupid getting burned like that. I thought I'd get him, but he burned me right back. So
that's all right.
That was great.
It happens. Jack Mack, I think of you and you know, a lot of our practices, you know, floating around practice before practice actually started, and you half clappering pucks across the ice with Jack Mack's blades and having the speed wobble. I mean, this guy was a beauty. You know, talk a little bit about Jack and some of the beauty stories this guy had and how he interfaced with the team.
Oh, he was great, wasn't he? One of the best coaches that we had, and just brought, he was so loose, made everyone feel comfortable. Like, you know, after a big loss the next morning, you put a smile on your face.
Bing,
and,
bang, boom.
Yeah. Oh,
bing, bang,
boom. You betcha. he was, by the end of the night on the road, like the night before, usually if I'd go to dinner or whatever, come back, I could hear Bucky outside of the hotel before I even got in. Yeah. You come in and voices, his white mustache is purple from all the wine he had.
You know,
God bless him. And I never forget the one night we were in Carolina, and I came in pretty late, and he was in the lobby talking to a couple people, and he was maybe massaging a foot or two.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm like, Bucky, what are you doing? I couldn't even understand what he was saying. So the next morning, The coaches are meeting before they go up for the rake. It was an early game. It was like 5 o'clock game. So there's only a couple guys skating. So Bucky's nowhere to be found. So Joey Mullins, like, calling him. No answer. Goes up, bangs on his door. Here comes Bucky. Opens his hair is everywhere, right? Stash is purple. Throws his clothes on, comes down, and I guess it just didn't even comb his hair, what little he had at that time. And Joey said, "Would you comb your hair with a pillow, or what'd you do, you know, Bucky?" And so he comes to the rink, and he says, "Oh," I said, "Hey, Buck Diddy, good morning, man." He's like, "Oh, Buck Diddy's hurt." I said, "Oh, you a little hungover?" He goes, "No, just a little tired." And you know, we always said that.
That point on,
just a little tired.
He's a beauty.
I remember too in practice, he'd always like pass the guys, you know, the half moon after practice or whatever.
And,
who wants it? Who wants it? And then you know, he made a couple nice passes. "Oh, they call me the tailor because I can thread the needle."
Yeah, he's a beauty.
He's too good, man.
Oh yeah, he's a great assistant coach for sure. So after you left, you left Philly, so you get traded in the offseason, about 2014.
Yep, I think
What was your original reaction there? And then, you know, going to Columbus where, you know, Torts is the head coach. I mean, what were your feelings going into that one?
Well, I was sad to leave Philadelphia, right? And, I signed a six-year deal, extension, I think, the year prior. Hextall came in and, you know, I think trade me was kind of putting his mark on the team. And you know, I was a little obviously frustrated, and you know, you have your house set up and your buddies,
right,
and you feel like you're building something, and you know, to kind of be forced to say goodbye, it was kind of tough. But you know, coming into Columbus, you know, I was excited about that team, but then you know, started 0-8, and Todd Richards gets fired, Torts comes in, and
oh, that's right, yeah, Torts wasn't even there.
We played one season with Todd Richards, and then we started 0-8. There's no chance you're making playoffs from that. And then Torts came in, and it was just like an overhaul. He's he's a character. He's demanding. Like mentally, he'll tear you down into nothing, and then he'll build everybody up the same way. The way, you know, you're a piece of the puzzle here, and you're here, and. And he was good to me for, you know, for a while, I guess. I was maybe, you know, one of his good guys. And then I was, you know, older guy, maybe getting a little slower. And, you know, it started to push me out. But a lot of stories with that guy. He's a maniac.
Oh, he is, eh?
Don't put words in my mouth.
I wish I could give you a explanation about it. I can't.
I've already heard enough of that crap already, as far as this is concerned.
I wonder what would happen if we did it to their two whining stars over there.
Kiss my ass if you have... if you want to write something different.
They'll whine about something else over there, won't they?
Starting with their two stars.
You got to throw one out there. I mean, there's got to be something golden because, I mean, you at one point you get a healthy scratch towards the end there. I mean, your relationship with him, what was it?
Yeah,
like,
a lot of respect for him. One of my favorite coaches. Good. Is just how he turned us around so quickly.
Right.
Had a healthy or got healthy scratch. I think I took a penalty towards the end of a game and it wasn't really a bad penalty. It was, I was fighting for a puck and it was actually in Montreal. PK Subban fighting for a puck. He,
dove.
Down he goes. And I'm standing there over the puck, taking to the net, and got a penalty. Of course, they scored. We lose the game 3-2.
Oh,
next game, my number's not on the lineup, right, for practice. And so I'm like, the extra forward and, feel stupid, obviously, even like one of my first times being healthy scratched after 1,100 games.
That didn't happen.
And so I go, go and talk to him, and he's like, we kind of had it out a little bit, and he goes, I appreciate you coming in here and talking to me like a man, I was a couple F-bombs and heated and whatever, and next day, he goes, don't worry about it, you're gonna get back in. He goes, this is your chance to prove to the guys how good of a pro you are. So I got bagged and smile on my face. Obviously it's tough to do that, but
right.
Felt as a good teammate. Next day, come in, and I think I scored like 4 goals in the next 5 games or something like that. Yeah. And he's probably like,
shove it up his ass.
Yeah. Like, I'm a great coach. You know what I mean? It always works like that too, right?
Oh, yeah, it does.
You've
probably
seen it.
Yeah. Oh, every time, I think it does that. Yeah.
But he was pretty wild. And another quick tour story. He was first like 8-10 games of the season. I'm on the fourth line with Sam Gagner. And we have like, I don't know, 8 points in 10 games or whatever it is, right? And in a close game, tie game, close game, we're up one or two goals. I couldn't see the ice last like 12, 15 minutes of the game. So I'm playing 8 minutes a night, right? And actually like almost leading the team in scoring, so I finally asked him, like, Torres, why can't I, get on the ice in the last 10 minutes? Like, he goes, you're way out of position defensively. Like, I don't trust you out there, number one, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, I'd love to watch some clips with you to see where I'm out of place defensively. Like, I think I'm doing a great job defensively. Nope, no, you're not. So anyways, the next day, he's like, I'm going to have, Brad Larson, the assistant coach, cut some film and, we'll show you how bad you are. And I'm like,
thanks. Confidence is high right now, Torres.
Next morning in practice, he comes up to me. He's like, I want to apologize to you. He goes, we looked at every single shift that you had in the first 8 games. He goes, you haven't been out of position once.
He goes,
it's my bad. It's my bad. He goes, I just think I don't trust you out there. He goes, it's just, I can't put you out there. I physically can't. And I'm like, holy shit, this doesn't make any sense, And
at least he's honest.
And that's one thing Torts is. If he doesn't like, one part of your game.
Right, holds it against you almost, right, yeah.
He's hard on his guys. And one more Torts story. Zach Werenski, one of the, best offensive defensemen in the league. It was his rookie year, and he might not be the best defensively. I think he's learned a lot in a few years, but we're in Winnipeg, and he's, a couple turnovers, like somewhat like late in the game and, maybe middle of the third period. And he goes, I don't want to see him out there any more shifts, right? to the D coach or whatever. And I don't know if he just lost count or whatever. He's like, Z and Jonesy, you go, and screws up one more time. Big, like, and they had a huge chance. And he goes back there, he goes, and Zach's coming off the ice too. He goes, set that rookie down. He's like, he's not seeing the ice again. And the kid hears the head coach, coming back to the D coach. Just crumbled.
Yeah.
He just, sits there and takes the tape off. He's like, I'm
that's
done.
It.
His skates are undone.
No grocery divider. Slide over.
Oh, man.
Slide
too
over.
Good, though. And it's tough love, right? That's the whole
thing. It really is,
You just coddle him and say, okay, better luck next shift. Right. And you're going to get scored on, lose the game. It's all about winning and losing. And Torts, doesn't make many friends out there, but he knows how to win. So.
He's a good human, though. Like,
yeah.
I mean, he really does care about you. Like,
yeah.
Hartsy, that.
Yeah.
He just knows how to push buttons and
get the most out of his players. I mean, sometimes you guys get complacent and they get too comfortable and they need that. What I mean? Especially as you become an older guy and, you think that you're invincible.
Yeah.
I remember telling him, rip your ass a little bit, and then you're good to go for another 10 games.
You say he's a nice human. He is like a super awesome human. And, I tell my family, I'm like, oh, he's so hard on me. I'm not playing or this or that. He got scratched or whatever. And my brother and his son came in, my nephew, and, they're there before morning skate or practice or whatever. And And, you know, towards the same thing, comes walking through and like, oh, hey, is this your brother? You know, and hey, little man, you playing hockey? You know, he's like 8 years old at the time, right? And sits and talks to us for 2-3 minutes, which is a long time for head coach and, you know, whatever bullshitting. And my brother goes, he's the nicest guy ever. What are you talking about? I'm like, he's bipolar or something. Right?
He's unreal, man. He's a good guy.
Yeah.
It's good to hear that.
Let's talk about you, Coach. Your hockey career, man. Like, how long we know?
What
each
about
other?
It? By one snipe?
Hey,
and the best goalie in the world? The best goalie in the
world? You picked the right one to score on.
Oh, man.
I've known you since you were 16, but you were a sniper back
in 2 years in Western Hockey League together.
Back in the day.
It's been an interesting ride for sure, you know. I retired in 2010 after our run there. And
10 years, crazy.
Yeah, it's been a long time. Yeah, it's hard to believe, really. But, you know, I think the game of hockey gave me everything it needed to, you know. It certainly wasn't anything fancy or sexy. No cups, no nothing, none of that. But a lot of life lessons, a lot of good relationships. You know, obviously you guys are sitting here. I learned a lot about myself, you know. Kind of the game pushed me into a corner. I retired another year in my contract. I don't know if you knew that when I retired.
Yep.
I just needed to get out of the game. You know, fighting took its toll, man. It's physically, obviously, but emotionally, spiritually. I wasn't playing that last year when Lavi came in. I just wasn't really in a good place. I wanted to stay in the game. So that's why I got into coaching there. But it gave me certainly a ton of tools to move on to the real world. And I'm thankful for it. Thankful for every piece of it. Honestly, it's been an awesome ride. And now it's awesome to do something like this, you know, sit down and instead, you know, kind of reconnect to our people in the name of hockey and share stories, because I think that's what it's all about. It's, you know, it's learning about yourself, being a team, growing, trying to win. Obviously, everyone's trying to win a Stanley Cup, but at the end of the day, once the game is over, all you got is the stories and, you know, your relationships. Yeah, so you know, here we are, right? I mean, it's awesome. So I appreciate you guys, doing this.
Let me ask this. What's the, like, top two things that you miss about playing?
The locker room, being the first guy at the rink and finding my little Zen time before, you know, it gets crazy. And then once the guys start coming in, man, it's just like, I just love being at the rink. I mean, even my last year of playing, I warmed up every single game of the regular season and playoffs. I think I played only 17 games. But I still got to the rink like 4 hours before the game. Just like, I just loved being at the rink.
Yeah.
Soccer was one.
I was going to say, I hope you say soccer.
Loved it. Just loved being around the guys. Loved the energy. Just loved the rink. I mean, I grew up at the rink, obviously, like we all did. And that was my favorite part. I mean, you know, getting into practice and stuff like that. I just wanted it almost to be over to shoot the shit. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's probably a bad, you know, bad approach, because I'm like thinking about after practice. But I just, you know, just like love being around the guys and having fun and going on the road, obviously, and dinners and, but yeah, soccer, being around the guys, and you know that world is just so awesome.
The first, you know, I've been retired 2 years now, and it's for sure soccer would be probably my number one. For sure thing. Like, I just,
yeah, it's amazing.
And just the laughs, like keeping you loose, you get a warm up, and you know, guys having those battles, you know, you'd go in and the arguments,
the hardcore one on one battles,
the sewering,
right.
You know what I mean? Like, no, it's your fault. No, that's for sure.
No effort. Where's your effort?
No effort. You're done.
And then Kimo, the mayor of the goddamn game, would come in. No, you're out.
Kimo says so.
Kimo, what do you think?
Yeah, you're done.
Okay. You couldn't argue with Kimo.
Oh, I know. What were you going
to
say?
Too much respect. Like, it's funny you said that to him, because that's what I was going to ask you. You've been retired. I know at first probably is a relief not having to go to the rink and do the hard workouts and all that stuff, all the work you put in.
Aren't you working out hard?
Huh?
Hey. Hey, now. Hey.
My favorite. So he was coming. Hartsy was coming to the Flyers rink. They let you come in and work out sometimes. And I see him over at the squat racks, and he's got these things plugged in. I'm like, what the hell's he doing over here? I go, his muscles are...
like this old stem machine.
And I was like, I don't know what he's doing, but he seems to be working. He's looking good.
A cheat code.
That's what I was going to ask you. Like, obviously, 2 years now, I know me, I'm not in it anymore, and I miss that part of it the most. Like, the guys in the mornings coming in, into the office, can he fit... three people and there's eight guys sitting in the office, and that's the part, like, just sitting in there with you back in the day and other guys, that's like one of the best things about it. That's probably what you missed the boat.
Well, like us listening to Mac Miller before the game, like no one even knows anything about that, right? But that 2 minutes watching that video before I take a shower, getting my stuff on and going for warm up, trying to get dressed as fast as possible. I guess my record's like just over 2 minutes, but from you and head G, to toe. But yeah,
it's impressive. I think I spent more time in your office than I did in the weight room and probably on the ice my whole hockey career.
Yeah, there's been a few guys that would like to sit in there, but that's the part I missed the most. I figured, you know, obviously you're lucky, you're doing a great job of the NHL Network and still getting to talk hockey and probably see some of the boys, but it's nice you're in the area too, like, so we could have you here.
Instead of doing the old Zoom call, you see your face to face.
Yeah, right? I know, right?
Exactly.
I wanted to ask you, Hartsy, going back to Philly, your best year was in 2011-12. I think you had 37 tucks. You're on a line with Jágr, I think the whole season, right?
Yep. For the most part,
playoff. It was a good thing you got to play. couple good players there, you and
Giroux.
Talk about that and, like, you know, playing with a guy like Yogs and his caliber and just being a vet. I don't know how old he was there, probably like 46 or something.
Yeah,
right?
He was high 30s, I think.
Yeah, he was close, over, he was close 40, to 40 yeah. for
he
sure.
He used to walk in the room, flex, right. Like 39 or whatever he was.
Yeah.
And kids were like, he's pretty jacked.
Yeah.
It was pretty wild. It was, you know, I played with Paul Kariya for a year or two in Nashville, Peter Forsberg. Like, those are the elite of elite, right?
Right.
And when we signed Yogs and, you know, who knew, like, I started that year on the fourth line with Matt Reed and Talbot, I think it was. I got a break to play with them. I told my agent, I'm like, oh my God, I'm playing with G and Yogs. Like, I need to have a good game. I need to snipe or whatever. Didn't score off the score sheet, but played like really good. I'm like, called him after the game. I'm like, I'm done. Like, I'm back on the fourth line, the ups and downs of playing. And then it was within the next game and I got 2 goals, 2 assists. And I was like, then we just like took off from there. And, just Yogs was, I wish I would have played with someone who was that good that worked that hard when I was 20.
Right.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Like to see that guy, the effort, the workouts before, after, at night, how he just loved the game. And obviously I loved the game, but the amount of work that he put in and he made me a better practice player. You know, he was telling me a couple times during the year, I was maybe hung titties or whatever in the morning and, you know, would kind of, you know, slough off through practice. But, and he would be like, hey, Hartsy, he's like, I didn't come here just to fool around. He's like, you practice how you play. He's like, I don't want to see you act like that again. And I'm like, you know, kind of, you know, shaped me up. Right.
Wow,
you know, and, you know, I kind of paid that forward throughout my career in Columbus and Nashville, right. Making sure everyone was on the same page and all that kind of stuff. But he was just a great human and just like always had a smile on his face. Yeah. Did he not?
He sure did. He did. He always did. Rarely you saw him where he was like pissed off. Like he just was always happy.
Yes, that's the only way you can play a sport till you're. When did he retire? Like when was he 44?
He's still playing.
He's still playing. So I don't know how old he is, but like you can only play a sport or do something that you love if you have a smile on your face and actually have a good attitude. Otherwise it would be like work, you know. It's not work for him. I mean, this guy's a machine and still arguably probably one of the best players on the planet.
It was pretty good line mates I had there that year. Drew would come up to me before the game, you know, half hour before the game. He's like, Scott, I feel so good tonight. He's like, give me the puck, go to the net. Like I want the puck on my stick, you know. And then literally a minute later I'm in the dressing room and Yogs, Scotty, he's like, give me the puck. He's like, I'm gonna dump it in your corner. He's like, you hold on to it. He goes, you got to wait maybe 3-4 seconds. I come pick it up. I'd be two guys and we score. And I'm like, okay. So I'm going to have the puck on my stick for like 0 seconds. You know, and sure enough, we had a great game, you know, 3-4 points, whatever it is. And just had a blast. And it was pretty good for me who I, you know, didn't really love the puck. You know, sometimes it wasn't my friend, right? Yeah. Just batting around. But these guys just, you know, just get ready to shoot every chance I got, get on net and end up having a few cookies at
that. Yeah,
he did close to 40.
Was that the same year in playoffs with the whole Hulkster incident? Is it against Pittsburgh?
He was leading up to it, wasn't it?
Was that the last game of the year?
Yeah.
It was before playoffs.
We were playing then. We already knew we were playing.
It was the last game of the year, game 82,
it was just
right?
A rodeo.
Yeah, that's right. All right,
it was,
yeah.
It was, I laughed my ass off. I think I had a towel up on my face because I was when there was a gentleman there, you know, was still like he dressed like the Hulkster, yeah. And he was fun to watch. Like I caught myself a lot just like looking over.
Okay,
he was awesome. He was awesome. And all this stuff's going on, and then I look over, Bird Dog's giving her this one.
Oh, yeah.
And our whole bench is losing it. Plus, Chief's holding on the lavvy because he's trying to go over the glass to get to their coach.
Was he throwing shit on the ice or was someone else? There's something that's trying to throw into the bench and it'll end up going on the ice.
Gentleman?
Oh, no, at that time. Oh, Pierre McGuire was like talking to Hartsy and they were picking some stuff up. And Hartsy,
it was a melee.
Much going on. Like, it was wild. That's
classic.
Man. But yeah. the place was going. You, as much as you were loved here, obviously, that city, they wanted your head on a platter, man.
So I shouldn't go there for dinner. Yeah, right? Yeah.
You know what, though?
I won't be working for the Pens, you're saying?
Yeah. Well, they'd love you. Once they know you, they would love you. But that was one of my favorite moments. And then in the playoffs, they got Hulk Hogan to do a thing. Remember, it was great. I didn't know it. And then all of a sudden, it pops up on the board. I was like, I'm looking at him going, he's ripping the shirt off. That was awesome, man. There was another melee. It was actually during that playoff series where you and Adams.
Yeah.
Adams.
Yeah.
And he was pulling your hair.
Yeah.
But it was crazy. Sid, who I love, he's a great man. Like, awesome dude. Everybody hates him in Philly, obviously, but he kind of started that whole issue. Like, I think he knocked Chemo's glove away.
Yeah.
And just one thing led to another. And Hartsy ends up fighting because someone jumped. I forget exactly how it happened, but you end up fighting and you actually fought. What kind of you fought? And then you guys got loose.
Yeah.
You're probably like, okay, somebody get in here maybe? Because that's not easy to do. I'm sure. I never did it, obviously, but
no, it was,
you two did.
It was pretty epic. How tiring is fighting, too?
Oh my God.
Like,
yeah, I wasn't very efficient fighter, and holding my breath and everything, but it's man, I can't even tell you how many times I was sitting in the penalty box and just hoping I didn't get a shift the rest of the game, which is probably a good chance I never did anyways, but yeah, man, I was so gassed, just drained the shit out of me, man. Yeah. Props to the guys like Cam Jansen, some of these guys that could fight for three minutes straight. Man.
What was your best fight, Coates?
Best fight?
Yeah. Most memorable?
Well, most memorable one is probably when I TKO'd Andre Waugh
when
Torts almost choked him out on the bench there. But, obviously most of the fights aren't that, they don't go exactly that way. You know, it's one punch, heavyweights and stuff like that. But a couple good ones with Sean Thornton.
Just measuring. Cote tries to grab Thornton, gets a couple of shots in. Oh, he directly got the head. Pounding away. It's Rock'em Sock'em Robots. The helmet comes off and Thornton is scoring. Give Cote credit. Their heart rates are in the 190s right now. Cote with two good lefts. Thornton over the top. They're wrapped up and they're yakking at each other. Pretty good bout.
In Boston.
There was like 1,500 punches thrown each guy.
Yeah.
I'll never forget when you guys squared up and Thornton's looking at you and you guys are kind of like this. And he goes, just like old times. As he's getting ready to fight. Thinking that? At that point?
He loved it, yeah.
Oh, yeah, no, he did. But I remember reading his lips saying, just like old times. I was like, my God.
Yeah, because we're both like undersized heavyweights, right? So when I actually fought a guy like was actually in the 6'1 range, was like, I'm like, okay. So it's not a 6'7", 260 pounder. So I knew, from the minors and stuff like that, I can open up with him, and we could fight, pretty aggressively. I think the first one he landed up being responsible for one of these breaks, at least one of them. But I remember being in after it's like my face is swollen, but I'm like in a great mood because it was like a great fight. What I mean? It's not like your nose is busted, but it's like that was just part of it. But I really don't miss that at all. You know what I mean? It's like
obviously not.
I actually liked the physical part of it. Like I liked the combat part of it, but it was like the whole emotional part of it is like think so much. You know, it's like every game I'm going into, I'm like, I'm gonna fight George the Rock or Don Brashear or some of these absolute mutants. But when's it gonna happen? You know what I mean? I fight him, and it's like, when's the next one happen? When Brash beat my ass the one time, it's like, well, I gotta go fight him again. So it's like constantly chronic state of anxiety. It's like night before games, like who am I fighting? When's it gonna happen? You know what I mean? So I don't miss that at all. I mean, it's like I'm at least be able to find some peace
you know, in my life with it, not having to worry about that shit. But it served its purpose. I mean, I needed to do it. I mean, clearly wasn't, an offensive player. And if I didn't fight and take on that role, I would have no chance in hell of ever playing one NHL game. So it served its purpose. And thankful that...
Dude, you're one of the best teammates that I ever had.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, sure were.
It's one thing I so many laughs. And it was just being... trying to be a good guy and have a good attitude, you know, whether it was
but just good say day if or bad. You, if you didn't have a good attitude and you didn't do what you did, you wouldn't have been around, right?
Of course
not,
yeah.
You know, you played 17 games and you warmed up every game.
Yeah.
Like a lot of people.
Yeah, that was on waivers too.
That would kill people. Waivers.
Yeah.
That would literally like, you know what I mean? Like, but you had the best attitude and you were the best teammate. And, you know, I just wanted to let you know that.
Yeah, for sure. Thanks, man. Appreciate that.
Craig Berube was talking to the guys a few years ago when he was still with the team, and they were asking about going into Detroit and fighting, you know, program.
Oh, yeah.
He's like, oh, yeah, try taking a pregame nap, knowing you got to fight this guy. And then when you get out of the box, Kosher's coming.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. He's like, no nap time. He's
no
like,
nap time.
You know, like, when you were just saying that, I can't even imagine, like, at least Chief, you know, he's a pretty big man. You were big at the time.
Yeah.
Like, you weighed a lot more, but you were still giving away 25, 30 pounds.
Oh,
even
yeah.
More of the Rock.
Yeah.
And I remember just like, I should tell you this, but I was just like, please God, don't let him get killed.
Yeah.
I remember fighting in Mellon Arena and you squared up with him. And I was just like,
knocking my helmet off like 30 feet.
The guy calling the game in Pittsburgh, He's calling the fight. He's like, Cote gets in the left, you know, George. And then all of a sudden he throws that one and thank God it skimmed you. But his helmet, you remember?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
20 feet and the guy commentating says, thank goodness Cote's head wasn't in that.
Yeah.
You know, and I remember that.
Oh,
I was
dying.
I saw that the next day and I was like, oh my God. But George Rock did go on to say that night in the papers that you were pound for pound the toughest guy in the league.
Yeah.
You never hid. You fought every tough guy and you did.
And that fight too, I actually talked to Georgie at one of the NHLPA meetings. I didn't know. I guess I hit him pretty hard in that fight and he thought he was going down and somehow he didn't. So I was like, oh, well, you almost knocked my head off.
And, yeah,
you
know, yeah,
it's nice to hear that I actually tagged you pretty good. And you said that, but yeah, that game, I forget it was an NBC game or a versus game. I can't even remember exactly, but they showed a preview clip of me warming up and like, I think maybe it was Pierre Maguire's like, look at this guy. He's in the zone. He knows he's fighting George Rock. He didn't even touch a puck. And you just see me just like skating around. It was like warm ups, not even touching a puck, just doing like these seat cut type of bullshit skating drills I was doing. It's like that was my mindset, right? I was like, I wasn't concerned about playing hockey. I mean, I was worried about like how bad this guy's gonna beat my ass and not get totally crippled. So different mindset.
You
hung
in there with him, man. That's amazing.
Yeah. I look back, I was like, wish I would have focused on hockey just a little bit more. You know what I mean? It's like, I was so consumed by the fighting. Cause I wasn't like, we played junior together. I mean, I fought a few times in 4 years in the Western League. I fought maybe 20, 22 times, which I was fighting 30, 35 times a year pro. So
yeah,
it's like, you know, you're still playing hockey. I was still playing hockey in Western hockey, even though I had a like diminished role. Then you're taking on this role. It's like, man, you know, I got to go all in. I mean, you can't half-ass fighting. You know what I mean?
No,
you can't just go in and it's like, oh, I'm just going to, you know, casually go into this fight against Don Brashear tonight. You know, so it's, I took, you know, just consume it, you know, taking boxing lessons and the jiu-jitsu and all the shit I was doing. But
so you did it well.
Man, my body feels pretty damn good now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Going back to Jágr playing with you, I remember that year Craig Berube was an assistant coach and, Jágr would get on the power play. He'd like to be on that wall. And he'd get over there and just massage the puck.
Yeah,
you know? Yeah. And Chief's losing his mind, right? But that was another good thing about Jágr. Like, Chief would give it to him. But Jágr would turn around and give it back. So he gets back to the bench. He goes, hey, boy, Jágr, we had to kill it off for him. And we're just dying. And Jágr is like, you played a lot of power play, eh, Chief?
Yeah.
And, you know, and Chief's like, nope, I didn't. You know, hey, you like big tits? Turn to me and say, oh yeah, okay. Anyway, I thought of that last night when you get the power play with Jágr, you know, like Chief was like, cool. Killed it off for him again, Jágr's out of boy.
Hartnell Down, talk about it a little bit. I mean, I think it was so fitting how you took something, I don't know, maybe was started as a negative, but it's like you just turned it into something so positive. And
I tell us, yeah, people that ask about it, it's a great story. And we were in, I think we were in Phoenix, and I saw the sign in warm-up, and it was like Hartnell Down, 145. And I'm like, what does that mean? I'm like, And this is like middle of the year, like game 50. And I'm like, what the hell is this?
Some kind of countdown.
Maybe it was game 30, who knows? Yeah. And then like two games later, we're in Anaheim and it was like Hartnell down 162. And I'm like, what does this mean? And, you know, it's up however many. And I'm like, Nasty, can you go and talk to those guys? And, or, you know, that, I think it was a guy and a girl. Can you go talk to them and figure out what's, you know, what this Hartnell down thing is or whatever? So he goes warm up, right? And he looks at me. He's like, Scotty, come here. And so I like leave the dressing room and he goes, you're never going to believe this. he goes, they count how many times you fall down on the ice. I was like, what? He goes, yeah, they count how many times you're like, I don't know if you get tripped or fall down or get hit or whatever. And I'm like, these assholes, like, you know, whatever. So I tell my agent and he starts laughing, Hartnell down, hilarious, right? And Twitter obviously is still huge, but it just was kind of booming for athletes and stuff like that. Right. And we got the hashtag Hartnell down, and you know, there's all kinds of drinking games. Like if he fell down, you do a shot, right? Yeah. And people were, you know, doing 7, 8 shots, 10 shots during buckle, a game, buckle just buckle it in. Yeah. But yeah, then we made this, I think my agent's wife got these 500 t-shirts, sold them, and they were gone in like 10 minutes, right? I tweeted about it and people went on and bought these $20 t-shirts. And then, you know, she got 2,000 of them. I tweeted, oh, they're back in stock. Boom, they're all gone. And, you know, next thing you know, we had, you know, $10,000-$15,000. Like, oh, let's start a charity. And you end up working with Ed Snyder Youth Hockey Foundation, got some kids from Philly to go to the Minnesota hockey camps where I was training at. And yeah. TJ Oshie, Wayne Simmons, like a bunch of, you know, good hockey players. So these kids are coming. 12, 13, 14 year old kids are coming to Minnesota and training with us. And it was just real cool to see how something, so someone poking fun at you, you're you right. turn it into something so positive. Amazing. and giving back. So it was just hilarious how it all started. And boys were loving it and chirping me on Twitter and face to face. It was great.
That's great.
That's
a lesson for
people. I
honestly like never paid attention to that just because of the game. You know, you're going to fall. Like everyone falls.
Yeah.
But once.
Yeah, once
we found that out, I felt like the whole game, I'm like, it went down again.
Oh, right? Two,
like, and, you know, in your head, you're like, but it was funny, but, you know, not making fun way, but just it was, I never paid attention. I never noticed that he was going down a lot, but it turned into a great thing.
It's like when you're driving around or you're looking at a new car, like, oh, I want to buy a Ford truck. All you see is Ford trucks on the road, right? Or you want a Chevy Suburban, right? And then all you see is Chevy Suburban, whatever car it is. Yeah. You just see those things and you're like, you know, same thing. Hawk, me falling down. I'm like, I didn't even know he fell down 15 times today. Yeah.
I really
now
I
have
never
to blame
knew.
It on you. Flipping trainers.
Thank goodness I wasn't doing this. Yeah. But like your first year, like it was, I mean, not just pumping your tires, but obviously you're one of my favorite guys I ever had. Come through there, and that first year I was looking at our roster. What a bunch of beauties. Like Uppy, Loops, Richie, Karts, you, Chemo. I wrote a lot of the gags. Steve Downey.
Yeah.
Downs. And Eags, Riggs, Jonesy. I mean, just I was just like looking, I'm like, that thing started coming back to my head. What a year we had. Like it was so much fun, man. It was awesome. Year. A lot of laughs and even the 2009-10 team when you guys made that great run and throwing car bomb and ash into the mix, just beauty yeah. team, man. It was a lot of fun.
Darren Trasham.
Yeah.
Little Darren Trasham.
Yeah. The year before we got ash, they had a great fight in Jersey. I don't know if you remember.
Yeah, remember.
You buckled him and then he kind of half buckled you.
Yeah,
it was all like neither one of them
go down. I mean, I swear to God, I hit him so hard. Oh, like I feel him going down and he went all down to like a squat and then
and keep it
back up and just started throwing. Just, Jesus, this guy.
Yeah,
man.
That was an unbelievable fight. And then he comes. You know,
Austin,
yeah,
he's
just
an awesome
what a
dude. Awesome
great
teammate
guy,
too.
Man. Oh yeah, love.
We're gonna
that
get
guy.
Him on.
Remember when Ash thought he was a better skater, faster skater than me? You remember this?
I don't.
And we had the skate off before practice one day.
No way.
He's like, I'm faster skater than you. He's like, Scott, I'm faster skater than you. I'm like, no, you're not. He goes, 100%. He goes, let's race. I'm like, anytime. He's like, all right, perfect. Before practice, we'll go. And we're on the other, the first sheet ice, and sure enough, we're on opposite red lines, and we go, you know, one full lap, and I think he pulled up after the last corner. I was like 20 feet ahead of him, right?
I was dehydrated.
Maybe.
He was so funny. He's like, no, my hammy. We'll go again later on.
Oh, yeah.
He didn't have to hold a hammy.
That man had a chin on him. He did go down one night. May not have been on the ice.
Oh, yeah, right.
Halloween night.
Halloween night.
Oh, man.
He's a beauty.
Yeah.
So what are you up to now? You're working for NHL Network. You're a father of two.
Yeah.
I mean, changing diapers and...
Flipping diapers like I'm flipping cheeseburgers. No, it's great. Yeah, my 2.5-year-old son, a 6-month baby girl, little Ginge.
Yeah, and, in the thick of it.
It's been so exciting, and you know, watching, you know, obviously you guys are, you know, you're going through. You have young kids and little Elvie. Shout out to Elvis.
Yeah,
it's just amazing watching them learn how to speak, how to walk, how to, you know. Like how I walk or how I take a shower, you know, me and my little one take a shower, and I, you know, always have just kind of play with my hands behind my back, and he's sitting there, he's doing the exact same thing. And I'm like, wow, this is, you're
like
so,
clones.
They're so impressionable, and whatever you do, they're going to follow and copy. And, you know, he's got quite the little humor on it, or sense of humor on him. So it's, awesome. Just amazing to, feel that love. You know, obviously I played my whole career being, you know, almost single basically the whole time, and perfect time for me to have a kid. I'm around all the time and
kids,
and so it's pretty amazing.
It's important stuff, eh? The time with the kids.
Yeah.
Now you're not traveling as much. I mean, I don't know how much you're traveling with that.
Not traveling anywhere now.
But previous to that, you know, it's important stuff. You know what I mean? You take it for granted. I mean, I didn't have kids when I was playing, but I know a lot of guys do. And
yeah.
Not that we're the Major League Baseball when you're gone for like 2 weeks at a time, but you know, Western road trip, you're gone for a long period of time. Yeah. And you know what I mean? It's like that time, even, you know, girls are at daycare right now. It's like super pumped when I pick them up. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, it's like such a important piece of life.
Yeah.
You appreciate that when you get older. So with, so I wanted to ask a question about philosophy on success. I mean, obviously you're successful in your own craft of, you know, hockey, and, you know, you're drafted, you know, high when you're 18 years old and had an amazing junior career and then an NHL career. I mean, what are like the pillars of your philosophy for being the best you could be, you know, as a hockey player and a person too, you know,
so
comes hand in hand.
Yeah. Well, I think just obviously good family.
Bill.
Wild Bill Hiccup.
Wild Bill Hiccup. My man.
The father's trips are amazing.
Yeah.
Obviously, remember Braden Coburn's brother?
Oh, yeah.
He's on the bus or whatever after dinner. They're going back to the hotel to drop us off, right? And the dads usually go for a couple beers. And he goes back. He's like, hey, Bill, you want to get shitty tonight? I'm like, what? I'm like, seriously? My dad's like 70. Put him down for the count. But to get back to your question, my dad always asked me whether it was baseball or hockey, which I played both growing up, who was the hardest working guy in practice? And, you know, I always didn't want to lie to my dad, right? So I always kind of put in the work. When I was doing something, whether it was, you know, schoolwork, whatever, yard work, it was, I put all my effort into it. And you know, still when I was playing, you know, 28 years old, 35 years old, still playing, he's like, who's the hardest guy in practice? And I'd call him after practice on my drive home or whatever. And, you know, I kind of had that instilled in me that I wanted to work hard and do that. And, you know, just watching the game, I had older brothers that played, you know, I think that I thought the game faster than I might not have been as fast as, you know, this guy or not enough skill as this guy or, you know, with the puck or whatever. But I just felt that I thought the game faster than probably those guys that could probably move faster where I was in better position or whatever. Right. And I think that's kind of what, why I had such a long career and good career was just that, you know, mentally I was probably a little bit sharper than in a lot of people that were on the ice. Right. And that's why, you know, Crosby, he knows where the puck's going to be before he knows where his teammates are going to be. Cause he can think the game at the highest level. And, I don't think everyone has that obviously as good as him. I'm not saying I'm as good as him, but, that's kind of why I think I lasted so long.
Yeah. And you're a little bit of a physical specimen. I remember you're like a bit of a man child in junior.
Yeah. I was 6 foot at like 13 years old, right? Like pretty good when you're playing Pee Wee Double A and you're just running over guys and scoring at will.
Oh, yeah. And when you come into the Western hockey, like 16, you're quarterbacking a power play. I remember that.
Yeah.
You know, like it was yesterday. But he also was still, he took on that power forward role right off the bat, too. I remember, you know, like it was yesterday, you back checking through the middle of the ice and Todd Fedoric was on the Regina Pats. And he cuts through the Friggy's skating with the puck down the ice, cuts through the middle of the ice, Hartsy runs him over, one of the biggest hits I ever seen. And I thought, you know, I was like, oh man, I mean, this,
I'm gonna die. I'm gonna die.
Fridge got traded to our team. I think it was like a month later.
No, the next day.
Was it the next day?
It was back to back games. No, Kevin McCullen was our coach.
Yeah,
it was home and home. And in PA, that's when I rocked him right at the end of the game.
Yeah, huge brawl.
I fought one of their defensemen, and we're literally the next day we met at the rink. We're driving. Gonna drive there. Coach called me in. He goes, I got some good news and bad news. And he's like, the good news is we just traded for somebody. And I'm like, it's Todd Fedoric. He's like, so you don't have to fight him tonight. So we saw him in the locker right before. He goes, thank God. And he actually said to me, he goes, thank God. He's like, I'm on your team. He goes, I wanted to fuck kill you.
I was fuming.
I'm like, nice to meet you, Todd. You know, I'm 16, right? He was 20 year old.
Oh yeah!
So,
he's a beauty too.
I got a good question for you guys. Who, in all your years playing, was like the most undercover funny guy or goofy guy or whatever, like that you played with?
Well, a couple come to mind. Probably my best buddy, Chemo, teaming in. Guy is hilarious. I don't know if I like him because he'd laugh at all my stupid jokes. You know, he played cards. Yeah, we were roommates for, you know, 3-4 years in Nashville, 3-4 years here, so 6-7 years and. You know, we spent a lot of time together, a lot of rouge releases.
Brimmed.
He's even funnier when he gets at it too.
When he starts laughing, his smokers finish laughing. Yeah. and Aaron Ashton too, one of the funniest characters, and just a great sense of humor. And you know, really, there's not too many like not fun guys, that have good personalities in the game of hockey, but. Darren Trasham and Chemo for sure would be my top two. What about you, Riggs?
I was actually going to say Ash. You know, right away he comes to mind. He's got that, you know, innocent little face, the smirk. But he's so witty. You know, he just has clever ways of relaxing the room and making funny. So I mean, he comes to mind for sure.
He's hilarious.
The beauty. Well, appreciate you coming on, man. This has been awesome.
Yeah, it's nice to tell stories. This is awesome.
Do it again. You're welcome anytime to the old studio here.
Good luck with the podcast, Nasty Knuckles.
Thanks, yeah, man.
Awesome.
Appreciate it, man. Great first cast, that's for sure.
Thank you, guys.
This has been great.